Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, and welcome back to this next video. And this is the fourth video in the series of videos on the cancers. And in this particular video, I want to focus on the carcinogens and the co-carcinogens and some of the methods of the carcinogenesis. If you talk about cancer, there are about 200 known different types of the cancer that affect the human beings. And these 200 different types of the cancer, they account for about 1/5 of all deaths in the industrialized countries of the Western world. If you talk about the types of the tumors, there are usually two types of the tumor. One is known as the benign tumor, and the other one that is known as the malignant tumor. And I have detailed videos on the benign tumor and the malignant tumor and the differences between the benign and the malignant tumor. And I'll share the link in the description. One of the terms that we use is carcinoma in situ. Now this carcinoma in situ, it is known as the potentially malignant neoplasm. What I mean by the potentially malignant neoplasm is that these carcinoma in situ, they are not malignant, but they have the potential to be converted into the malignant tumors. Now these carcinoma in situ, they usually do not invade and destroy, just like the malignant tumor, which have the property of the metastasis and the invasion. The carcinoma in situ, they usually do not invade and destroy, but given enough time, they have the potential to be converted into a cancer. One of the important example of the carcinoma in situ is that is a Bowen's disease. And this Bowen disease is a very early form of the skin cancer that easily treatable. That means that this is tumor in nature, but you can easily treat it. But if you are not going for the treatment of the Bowen disease, it can be converted into the malignant tumor and hence cancer. Now the main sign of the Bowen disease is a red scaly patch on the skin, as you can see in this particular image. This is actually the Bowen's disease. It's very easily treatable, but if you are not going to treat it and if you are giving it time, it has the potential to be converted into the malignant tumors. The Bowen disease, it actually affects the squamous cells, which are the outermost layer of the skin, and sometimes is also referred to as the squamous cell carcinoma in situ. So the squamous cell carcinoma in situ and the Bowen's disease, that actually refer to one in the same condition. When you talk about the cancer, there are two kinds of the terms that we use. One is known as the carcinogen, and the other one that is known as the co-carcinogen. This carcinogen, it's actually an agent that has the capacity to cause cancer in humans. What I mean by this is that they have the ability to cause cancer in the human without the help of anything. But when you talk about the co-carcinogens, these co-carcinogens, they are actually the chemical or agents that promote the effect of a carcinogen in the production of cancer. This means that the co-carcinogen, they alone do not have the ability to cause cancer, but they have the ability to promote the effect of the carcinogen, thereby severing the effect of the carcinogen. Now usually this term co-carcinogen is it refers to the chemicals that are not carcinogenic on their own, such that an equivalent amount of the chemical is insufficient to initiate carcinogenesis, or in simple terms you can say alone they do not have the ability to cause cancer in the human beings or any other living system. For example, the sodium arsenite, they can be administered to mice at low enough concentration that it does not cause tumor on its own, but it actually increases the rate of formation and size of tumors formed after the UV exposure. So if in a mice there is tumor that has been made after exposure to the UV, the sodium arsenate, that can further complicate the things and that can further increase the rate of formation and size of tumors. There are different types of carcinogens, and in this particular table I'm showing you the different types of the carcinogens with examples. The first type of the carcinogen that are known is the chemicals or the substances. For example, the nickel, the cadmium, the arsenic, the nitrosamines, the trichloroethylene, arylamines, the benzopyrene, the aflatoxins and the reactive oxygen species. So these are usually the examples of the carcinogens under the heading of the chemicals or the substances. The second type of the carcinogens, they are known as the environmental or medical radiations. And the important type of the environmental radiations, that will be the UV radiation, especially the UVB part of the UV radiation from 280 to 315 nanometer. When you talk about the range of the UV, it usually starts from like 150 to 400 nanometer, but not all of the UV range that is a carcinogen. The particular range of the UV that is carcinogen, that is known as the UVB region of the UV spectrum, and it is usually between 280 to 315 nanometer. When you talk about the medical radiations, one of the example that will be the ionization radiation that you can actually use in the treatment of the cancer, and the X-rays that you are using actually in the diagnostic process. The third type of the carcinogens, they are known as the biological carcinogens, and in the biological carcinogens, a different kind of the bacteria and the viruses, they are actually the causing agent of the cancer. For example, the human papilloma virus, that is actually causing the papilloma, one of the type of the benign tumors that I have discussed in the differences between the benign and the malignant tumor, and I'll share the link in the description. Bacteria can also be responsible for the causing cancer. For example, the Helicobacter pylori, that would be one of the example of the bacteria that is under the heading of the biological carcinogen. The fourth type of the carcinogen, they are known as the indigenous processes. The processes happening inside the cell, when they are responsible for causing cancer, they are usually put under the heading of the indigenous processes. For example, the DNA replication, you all know that during the process of the DNA replication, the DNA polymerase, it do make some mistakes, but due to the proofreading ability of the DNA polymerase, most of these mistakes, they are removed and they are corrected. But sometimes the problems in the DNA replication, they can be one of the cause of the cancer. And then that will be under the heading of the carcinogen, specifically under the indigenous processes. The metabolic reaction generating the reactive oxygen species or the chronic inflammation. These are actually the mechanisms that are happening inside the cell. Therefore, we put them under the indigenous processes. Some of the medications, they are also carcinogens. For example, some chemotherapy drugs and the hormonal therapy that can raise the risk of cancer. For example, some of the chemotherapeutic agents like the cytoxan, which is used to treat the women with early stages of the breast cancer, that may sometime lead to leukemia. So in this particular case, this particular drug that you are using for the treatment of a specific cancer, that can actually lead to the formation of another cancer. The oral contraceptive use may increase the risk of breast cancer in the young woman. Lifestyle, that can sometimes also be a carcinogen, specifically the smoking and the obesity, they are put under, they are both carcinogens. It means that they had the ability to cause cancer in particular individuals, and they are actually responsible for mutations which result in cancer. Pollution, that can be another type of the carcinogen, and both outdoor and indoor air that may contain pollutants, that may contain carcinogens, and if they are carcinogens, that means they have the potential to be causing cancer in particular individual. So these are the broad types of the carcinogens and the different classes of the carcinogens with their examples. When you talk about the method of the carcinogenesis, how these carcinogen that actually cause cancer in the human beings or in the living cells. Now, the biochemical mechanism of cancer development associated with physical agents is uncertain. In this particular video, I specifically be focusing on the physical agents, and several theories are there that how these physical agents that can actually cause cancer in particular individual. Now, one of the theory that holds that the physical particles cause irritation in the surrounding tissue. When a physical agent it enters into the body, it is actually responsible for causing irritation in the surrounding tissue, and the end result of irritation is inflammation. If I summarize the whole thing in two words, how these carcinogens generally they cause cancer in the living system is, if they are causing inflammation in the living organisms, and that inflammation is actually responsible for causing cancer in that particular individual. In the second case, there will be a direct DNA damage, and that particular direct DNA damage will be responsible for causing the cancer. So these are the two main phenomena that are responsible for causing cancer. One, inflammation, the second, damage to the DNA. So one of the theory that I've told that is the physical particles, when they enter into the body, they are responsible for causing irritation into the surrounding tissue, which results in inflammation. And the body normal inflammatory response that involve proliferation of the surrounding cells and infiltration of the tissue with new cells. This is the main phenomenon that is followed in the living system after the inflammation. Now, as the particles remain in place, and the normal tissue continues to undergo proliferation, some cells mutate and they are actually converted into the neoplastic cells. So as I've told you, one phenomena is the inflammation that will ultimately lead to mutation in the DNA, and that mutation in the DNA will be actually responsible for the creation of the neoplastic cells. Now, this idea of the inflammation leading into mutation is supported by studies showing the particle of the asbestos and erionite with larger surface area to have a high risk of cancer. That means those particular individuals which have a higher exposure to the asbestos, they are actually at higher risk of the cancer. Now, these asbestos and the erionite, they have got larger surface area. It means that that will be coming in contact with a larger number of cells, that will be creating a larger inflammation, and the larger the inflammation, that means larger are the chances of the mutation, and if the mutation chances are increased, that means that the formation of the neoplastic cells, that will increase. Now, in experimental animals, the prolonged exposure to the airborne particles that actually results in the accumulation of the particle within the lungs, and when they accumulate, that means they will be causing irritation in the lung, there will be inflammation in the lung, and this theoretically a chronic inflammation that will be responsible for causing increased cellular mutation and hence cancer. Now, another theory is based on the fact that some of the physical materials, when they enter into the body and they are there in the body, they undergo a deterioration over time. And when there is a deterioration, this means that there is some sort of chemical reaction between the physical agent and the surrounding tissue. And one of the end result of the interaction of the physical agent with the surrounding chemical environment, it actually have carcinogenic effect on the cell in the vicinity, which can have the ability of the formation of the neoplastic cells and hence the cancer. So this is another theory that the physical agent is having a chemical reaction with the chemical environment of the cell. It is converted into a carcinogen, and when that is converted into a carcinogen, that means it have carcinogenic effects. One of the important phenomena that is happening on the molecular level is that the chemical reactions of the some carcinogens that actually results in the formation of the reactive oxygen species and the reactive nitrogen species. So when there are chemical reactions because of the carcinogens, and if there is the formation of the reactive oxygen and the reactive nitrogen species, these reactive oxygen species and reactive nitrogen species, they are actually responsible for causing damage to the DNA. And if that particular damage in the DNA is in those particular genes which are controlling the cell cycle of the living organisms, that means if there is damage, the control on the cell cycle, that will be lost. And when the control on the cell cycle that is lost, that means you'll be having the neoplastic cell and hence abnormal growth. Now, these reactive oxygen and the reactive nitrogen species, they are capable of physically damaging the DNA because they have got a very small size that can actually enter into the nucleus, and they can directly interact with the DNA, thereby physically damaging them. And a number of studies that have shown that the physical carcinogens, like including the fibers such as the asbestos and the metal such as the nickel and the copper, they have the ability to produce the reactive oxygen and the reactive nitrogen species within the cell, thereby causing damage to the DNA, thereby creating cancer in those particular cells. Now, some metals such as the nickel and the arsenic, they are such small particles that they can travel inside the cell and they directly damage the DNA. And they can do this by altering the structure or interfering with the normal functions of the DNA. Another important phenomena or another important theory you can see is that the physical material to cause cancer is by electrical forces. Now, you may have seen surgically implanted metals in individuals such as that are used in the joint replacements. They are actually responsible for cancer. And what they do is that these kind of the cancer, they occur due to the electrical forces on the surface of these metals, causing DNA damage to the surrounding tissue. So the electrical forces present on the surface of these metals, that is actually responsible for causing damage to the DNA of the surrounding tissue. And when there is damage to the DNA, that means you can expect the formation of the neoplastic cells and hence cancer. Now, these implantable devices that may also increase the risk of cancer if they are associated with long-standing infection, especially those infections with those particular organisms which have the ability to cause cancer on its own, or is these pathogenic bacteria or the other organism, they are responsible for causing inflammation in those particular areas of the body. That means inflammation will lead to mutation. Mutation will lead to the formation of the neoplastic cells and hence cancer. If you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button and share it with your friends. And we will continue the discussion in the next video.